Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Ignacio Ramirez, aka Iggy. I'll be your moderator for this morning's class session. And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operations of eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine panoramic vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario, California branch school was established in May of 1988. Now, in the school, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles of the Heavenly Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name. But Jesus is an erroneous name, a minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Now, we've drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man cannot perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this institute are as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the devil, the serpent, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watcher is peace. Our slogan is to speak the truth. Now we have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter. Our scripture reader will be Irene Ramirez. And we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
This is a time of prayer. It's about our heart and mind. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for keep this teaching going on. This is the plan of salvation that you give us from the beginning of the creation. I ask you for mercy on us, because the world is very in turmoil, and keep us in a good shape. That way we can keep learning about your purpose and your plan. And, I say all those things and you only sign name Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hold on. Hold on. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Morning, class.
Good morning.
Morning. I'll be reading 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter, and I'll be reading from a King James Version. This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you, in both which I stir up your pure minds by the way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and of the commandments of us, the apostles, our Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and asking, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of that, by the word of Yahweh, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was, being overflowed with water, perished. But the heavens and earth, which are now, by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto the fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodliness of men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that the day of Yahweh is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years was 1 day. Yahweh is not slack concerning his promise, as some men continue slackness, but is long-suffering towards, not willing that any should perish, that all should come to recompense. But the day of Yahweh will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works therein shall be burnt up. Seeing then that all these things be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation of Yahweh, knowing for and hasting unto the coming of the day of Yahweh, wherein the heavens shall be on fire and be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blemish, and blameless. And account that the longsuffering of our Savior, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, were written unto you. And also in all his epistles speaking in them, all these things in which some are hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest as they also than the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest also ye be led away with the error of the wicked. Fall from your own steadfast, but grow in grace and the knowledge and the knowledge of our Savior, Yahshua Messiah, to whom be glory now and ever. Let's all say hallelujah.
There at the beginning. Okay, now, good morning once again. This is our Sunday morning class, okay? Now we have some first-time visitors here. And can you announce them from your desk over there?
I didn't even get
the book. Oh, you get the book?
Why don't you just announce your name?
Okay, announce your name.
Steve Brown.
Okay. And
Joe Rivera
and his two kids there.
Okay.
Okay. Now, as explained in moderation, this is a school, okay, so we're here to learn. And without further ado, our first speaker will be Dr. Will Williams.
Good
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
Yeah, it's good to be here. It's good to see you here, especially under these conditions, especially first-time visitors. We really appreciate you, you know, coming here to want to hear and learn what it is that we're talking about. And what we're talking about here is a divine vision and revelation that was given to the founder of this school. And that's what you see depicted here. What you see depicted here is in the Bible. It's in everybody's Bible, okay? But what we talk about here is a divine vision. I'll put it to you like this. It is a prophetic, divine, colossal, stupendous, panoramic vision and revelation, you know, that that really encompasses everything, okay? You heard our moderation, how the class got started, some of the principles and tenets that we believe in as far as our aims and objectives. The first one is simply this, is to help you find and know Yahweh as he really is and actually exists. Now, everybody has an opinion, you know, certainly. Yeah. And everybody has their theories and concepts of what they think, how this universe runs.
Right.
Okay. And of course, you know, you want to look at something, you know, and examine it. You know, we all come to something at first with a little bit of skepticism. You know, that's expected. You're supposed to. You can't just believe everything because somebody says so now, especially in this era now of fake news and stuff like that. See, you know, more so now than what it was, but it was always like that. But what we talk about is simply this, and I could probably narrow it down to three basic tenets of what we believe in here. The first tenet is what we call the unity of the spirit. That simply means this. One, it describes what spirit is. Two, it identifies what spirit is or who this spirit is. That spirit is Yahweh. See, now Yahweh is the all in all. The name Yahweh itself means he who brings into existence whatever exists, okay? If it exists because of the will of Yahweh. Now, we're going to explain how that comes about, see, because it comes about by what is known as spirit law. This is what he is. Now, he is the Father, he's the Word, and he's the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. Now, I'll come back to elaborate. Let me mention the other two tenets. The second tenet we believe in is the institution and fulfillment of the law and the prophets. That simply means this. What was the mission of this one right here? Whom the world calls Jesus Christ. What was his mission? Who was he? What was he about? Well, by his own words, he said, I come to fulfill. So the question you would ask is, well, what is he fulfilling? Well, that which was written about him, see, which we know as the Old Testament. See, the Jews call it the Torah, the first five books of the Bible.
Right.
The book of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, that's the Torah. The rest of the books, they call the writings. We call it the way the scripture says it, the prophets, the testimony. Or simply put, the law and the prophets. The first five books of the Bible in the Old Testament consist of what is called the law, which also consisted of these carnal ordinances. And the rest of the books from Joshua to Malachi consists of the testimony or the writings. He himself said he came to fulfill,
right,
to perform these things, see, because they were part of an Old Testament or an Old Covenant, so that by performing these things and ending them and moving them out of the way, it made it possible for a New Testament to be established,
right,
written in the heart and the mind, okay? Now, the third tenet we believe in is this divine pattern of the universe, as represented by this tabernacle pattern here that they built in the wilderness of Sinai. Moses and the Israelites did. This is a more bigger illustration. This is probably a more realistic illustration here. With the tabernacle, a court that went round about First part would be a holy place, then a most holy place. Here you have the 12 tribes of Israel gathered around this tabernacle, three on each side, right? And this was something that was divinely given. That means this. Yahweh gave the instructions and specifications on how to build this tabernacle. It wasn't the only thing he gave. He gave instructions on how to build this ark. Told Noah to build an ark and gave instructions on how to build it. Through David, Solomon was able to build this temple. But his father David received instructions from Yahweh by simply Yahweh waving his hand on his body and using his body as a template to build this temple. So all three of these devices were divinely given. So, and we simply say this, if they're divinely given, then they should be able to tell you something about the divine, mm-hmm. Okay? Now, just in a nutshell, those are our three tenets that we, anything we study in here is gonna fall into one of those three categories, okay? So now, we'll try to explore as much as we can on those three tenets, at least a basic foundation of it, if you will. So, to begin at the beginning, I'd like to begin at John 4:24.
John 4:24. For Yahweh is spirit,
mm-hmm.
and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Now, Yahweh is spirit, okay? Now, what does that mean? See, that means this. Yahweh is abstract. That means you cannot perceive him, right? He is the all in all, that is to say, the source and the substance of all existence. Matter that we see around us exists in basically three states, mm-hmm. solid, liquid, and gas. Matter is spirit materialized. Okay? Again, what is spirit? Well, we have these attributes up here. This is what spirit is. Spirit is the is wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, and strength. It's not the only attributes, but these are the primary ones of what Yahweh is. It's not something he possesses. This is what he is. He is the essence of wisdom, the essence of intelligence, knowledge, love. We manifest these things. I can show you, you know, some complicated equation to show how intelligent I am, or I can love my children, hug them, and express, that's an expression of love, but it's not pure,
right,
unadulterated love, which is what he is. Now, spirit, being in sense that it's abstract, and you can't perceive him in any, you know, it's just, it's impossible. Our founder had a very good statement I love. He said it like this. The human mind cannot conceive what it cannot perceive. Since you cannot perceive this pure spirit state of existence, then you cannot conceive anything about it.
Right.
Therefore, it behooved this pure spirit state of existence to put himself in a state mm-hmm. of conceivability or perceivability. And that would be John 1:1.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh.
Now, in the beginning was the Word, which was with Yahweh. Now, let's back over here for a minute. Now, up here, we have the Word or Son, which is Elohim. Now, Elohim is not a name. It's a title. But it's a divine title that Yahweh gives to himself. And the reason why he does that, because Yahweh is pure spirit. So for him to coming into shape and form or into a state of perceivability, which is known as Elohim or Yahweh Elohim, see, that simply means he's taken on the shape and form of a man, but not an ordinary man, but an anthro. An anthropomorphic man.
Okay. Now,
that simply means anthro means man. Morph, it means to shape. It means to form.
So what we're talking about when we say Yahweh Elohim or the Word or Son is Yahweh taking on the shape and form of a man, a super incorporeal man with unlimited capacities. Now, it didn't take all of Yahweh. Hold on, I keep going with it now. What is up? Is that, I need to do something?
It's when you turn away from it. So if you could put it in the middle.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Yahweh, you see, these attributes took on a shape and form, took on an organized shape and form. Now, it didn't take all of Yahweh to take on this shape and form. Good analogy would be this. If I was standing at the Pacific Ocean and I had an empty glass and I, you know, just scoop some water up, I would have a part of the Pacific Ocean in that glass. Now, whatever percent salty the Pacific Ocean is, it's going to reflect that in that glass. See, whatever's in the, it's going to be there. Now, somebody say, well, wait a minute. You know, there's whales and dolphins and barracudas and sharks. And, you know, they're in the ocean. And I was like, yeah, and guess what? They're in this glass, too.
Right.
Just in proportion. See, compared to the vastness
right.
of the ocean. This, it didn't take all of Yahweh for this to come forth. Because when Yahweh, pure spirit, in part, not in totality, took on shape and form, Yahweh, pure spirit, went out of business. And it's the Word or the Son that created everything. See, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. Is there anything else but that?
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
All things were made by him.
Uh-huh.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Now, just to add a little bit on top of that, we can get Proverbs 8:22. See, and see what the law and the prophets have to say about this. The Old Testament. See.
Proverbs 8:22.
Now, Proverbs is a book that was written by King Solomon. Right? But, go ahead.
Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his way, before his works of old.
As I said, Solomon wrote this book, but Solomon, in writing this, is not writing of himself.
Right.
Because Solomon wasn't back here in the creation, when, you know, when the creation happened.
Right.
It said, Yahweh possessed me. Who is right. The me you have to understand is this shape of this super incorporeal, great heavenly anthropomorphic being. That's the me that Yahweh possessed in the beginning. Meaning what? He took on shape and form.
Right.
And did what, read?
I was set up from everlasting, mm-hmm. from the beginning,
read.
Or ever the earth was.
Uh-huh.
When there was no depth, I was brought forth. When there was no fountains abounding with water.
Mm-hmm.
Before the mountains were settled. Before the hills was I brought forth.
Mm-hmm.
While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there when he set a compass upon the face of the deep.
Mm-hmm.
When he established the cloud above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep. When he gave to the sea his decree that the waters should not pass his commandments. When he appointed the fountains of the earth, then I was by him as one brought up with him.
Mm-hmm.
And I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him.
Mm-hmm.
Rejoicing in the habitable parts of his earth, and my delights were with the sons of men.
All right. Now that gives you a better description of who this is and what this is.
Right.
Okay. This is the Word of Son. This is the first cause of all creation. Of all what we call creation or the universe. And the universe is only in two distinct parts. There's a physical creation and there's an incorporeal creation or what we would even call an angelic creation. And we'll get to that. Go back to John.
4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
Now, in him was light, and this is the light of men. This is what lights everybody,
right.
No matter who you are.
That's right.
Even the people you don't like.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. This is the same light that's in Donald Trump, Vladimir Putin, the Pope, your mom, your dad, your worst enemy, your best friend. All 8 billion people on this planet, and before, and whoever comes after. This is the light that lights everybody up. Okay, but read.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Now, despite the fact that the light shineth in the darkness of 8 billion people, 8 billion people ain't aware of this.
Right.
Because, you're ignorant.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But he's there. He's been there all along. But your ignorance, you don't know about it. And whatever thought or that you thought about, you didn't really give it to the proper one.
Right.
You gave it to who you thought was the
right one.
Instead of giving it to the one who it really is.
Really, yeah.
Okay, is there anything else there?
Just 14.
Yeah, okay, yeah. She's going to jump down to verse 14, and it's going to say,
and the word was made flesh.
Now, this word that we just talked about, we read about in Proverbs, the same word that created everything is now made flesh.
And dwelt among us.
And dwelt among us. Read.
And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Now, this is the word made flesh. Now, this is not three individuals, because I grew up a Baptist. I got baptized on it. And they taught me that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Well, what you have here is two manifestations of the one spirit.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's echoed in 1 John 5 and 7.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Uh-huh.
The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit.
Uh-huh.
And these three are one.
Now these three are one. It's not these three are three, but these three are one. And people have... They haven't really figured out how to really explain that. Because when they explain it, they say, well, these three, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. They look at it like three distinct individuals.
Right.
Like if I had, I'll be God the Father, this is the Son, that's the Holy Spirit. I'd say, all right, I want you to create a creation, Son, and I want you to put birds and animals and plants and stars, and I want you to do that. This is what I want you to do, all right? But what do you think about that idea, Holy Spirit? You concur with that? That's how people think about that. And it's not like that. These three are one. And read.
And there are three that bear witness on earth.
Uh-huh.
The Spirit.
The water.
And the blood. And these three agree in one.
Now these three agree in one. In other words, these are three distinct witnesses that exist in the physical creation that points to the one.
Right.
The Spirit, the water, and the blood. Now you say, well, how does that manifest? How does that work? Let's keep reading.
Right. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of Yahweh is greater.
Now this is the witness of Yahweh. Read.
For this is the witness of Yahweh which he has testified of his Son.
Mm-hmm.
He that believeth on the Son of Yahweh has the witness in himself.
You have this witness in yourself.
Right.
Right.
I mean, what human being that isn't walking around here don't have blood running warm in their veins?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Water.
Right.
And a spirit.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, your existence is a witness to his existence.
Right.
And yet you have people who trust to call themselves atheists or an agnostic. An atheist is the person that don't believe in anything but themselves. They say, well, there's no evidence, for a creator. Here you are standing up there. Why are you atheist? And the agnostic says, well, I think there is a creator, but there's no evidence of it. Well, how are you standing here? How are you standing here? You got blood, water, and spirit, and that's the evidence to point him out, and you sit up and say, oh, there's no witness. There's no evidence that there's a being. And you walking around here,
Yes.
Is there anything else in that?
He that believeth not Yahweh has made him a liar.
Now, you didn't call him a liar. You just called him a liar. Oh, I don't believe it. And, and you're walking around as the evidence of his existence.
Right.
Anything else?
Because he believed not the record that Yahweh gave of his son.
This is the record. The spirit, the water, and the blood. That's the record. And this is the same record that permeates throughout the Bible. It permeates throughout the universe. Because when you say blood, water, spirit, that's really akin to saying death, burial, and resurrection.
Right.
Oh, I'm getting ahead of myself, but I may as well throw it in here right quick. 1 Corinthians 15 and 3.
Mm-hmm. For I deliver unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Yahshua died for our sins.
Now, saying how Yahshua died for our sin.
According to the scriptures.
See, that's a death. That's the same as death. Death and blood are synonymous. Mm. Read.
And that he was buried.
That he was buried.
And that he rose again the third day.
That he was buried, which is synonymous with water.
According to the scriptures.
And that he rose on the third day according to the scriptures.
Right.
Resurrection. Blood, water, spirit is synonymous with death, burial. Help me out, y'all. I'm frozen. Burial.
I-A-L.
Thank you. I don't know. Sometimes that happens when I get up here. Death, burial, resurrection. Okay? These are principles that you see throughout the scriptures and throughout the universe. But you wouldn't be here today if you didn't do a death, burial, resurrection. Were you not sleep, which is a type of death, and you were immersed in sleep, or you were even covered over with blankets, and then you woke up in this morning and got up out of the bed.
Right.
So you do that from a natural standpoint, death, but that's right. Death, burial, resurrection. These are little things that you see that's manifested throughout the universe that's proof that there is a creator, okay? Now, Matthew 3:13. Let's jump on our second tenet for a minute.
Matthew
3:13.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him.
Mm-hmm.
But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua answering said unto him, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Now, this is a thing, and look, I know about this because I said I grew up a Baptist, okay, so I know this story pretty good. Now, here's John the Baptist, who happens to be, when you read the story, was a relative of Yahshua the Messiah, a cousin. You know, in the flesh, according to the flesh. And he comes to him, and see, first of all, you have to understand, well, what is John the Baptist doing out here? What's his mission in the first place? Well, John the Baptist's mission is to bury the Jews. That's his mission. Water baptism is a type of a burial. See, and the only reason why you would bury something is because something is dead.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
So these Jews had to come. See, I know how it was with me. I was just 8 years old. Probably not much older than that guy over there. And the reason why I even joined the church was because they were having crackers and grapefruit juice. And I couldn't get none because I wasn't baptized. And so I was like, you know, every time they come out, you know, they would, you know, go down the road. And they come to me, you know, they would, like, do that little slip, and, you know. And so I was like, well, gee, I want to be part of the fun, too. And so they said, well, you got to join the church. Well, how do you do that? Well, just walk up there and have a seat. Tell them, well, you want to join the church. So I went up to the front of the church, told the preachers I want to join the church. They sat me down and made me a candidate for baptism. And it was in the pulpit too. Mm-hmm. You know, the tub was in, you know, they was literally in the pulpit. They pulled me in the pit.
You know, yeah. That's right.
So, but that was how, you know, and that's how people do. I mean, there's various ways, okay? In the old days, you know, I remember my parents, they used to go down by the riverside, you know, because of the flowing water, it would wash away, you know. Or some folks, like if you came up Roman Catholic, you got baptized not long after you were born, you know. That kind of thing, sprinkled you or whatever, you know. And so it's all different forms of it, but they all tie back to here on why they're doing it. Now, when you went up here to John to be baptized, I'll tell you what, I'll do a demonstration. Come on up here, Hudson. Okay, this is the candidate. I'm John the Baptist, all right? He comes up here, all right? He's got to confess, not just to me, because look, we over here, it just looks like two of them. But I have you know, there's a whole multitude of people out here on this riverbank. And what this guy's got to do, he's got to confess to the whole multitude that he could not fulfill Moses' law. And that Moses' law, let's stay right there, consisted of 613 ordinances. So if you broke one, you was guilty of them all. So he's got to confess that in front of everybody and in front of me, John the Baptist. I said, okay, confess. Just say, I can't do Moses' law. You can't do the law. But brother, as far as the law is concerned, you are dead. So I'm here to help you out. I'm going to baptize you, or I'm going to bury you. All right, so I get him in the water because we're in the water. All right, I baptize you unto the Messiah. Just go on your knees. Just bend down. I baptize you unto the Messiah's death, and then raise him up so that you will be in the likeness of his resurrection. Thank you much. All right, and that's what he had to do to the whole body of Israel. See, they had to be baptized unto the Messiah's death. Where's the scripture? We're coming back to that, I think. Get me Psalms 1. Yeah, Psalms 1.
Psalms 1.
Yes.
Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the wicked, nor standeth in the way of the sinner, mm-hmm. nor sitteth in the seat of the scoffer. But scornful. But the delight is in the law of Yahweh.
Get a little louder.
And in his law does he meditate day and night.
Mm-hmm.
And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water.
Now, she just said, in that law does he meditate day and night. In other words, he's performing this law. Because, see, he told John, thus it becometh us to fulfill
right.
all righteousness. Now, that right there is that's a lot in that phrase. Fulfill all righteousness. Mm-hmm. First, you have to find out, well, what does fulfill mean?
Right.
Fulfill means to complete. It means bring to an end, as of a promise. But it also means to perform, mm-hmm. because to bring something to its conclusion, you have to perform it. Mm-hmm. When he got baptized by John the Baptist, he was not initiating water baptism. He was performing it to bring it to its conclusion.
Right.
The conclusion came here at the cross. When he died, all of those ordinances died with it because he said on the cross, it is finished.
Right.
What is? The law. Mm-hmm. The law of carnal ordinances. He didn't say, I am finished.
Right.
He said, it is finished. Mm-hmm. See? But this is what he meditated on for 33 and a half years, performing this law. And not just performing the law, but performing 4,000 years of people, places, and things.
Right.
Yeah.
That's a, I mean, you stop and think about that. How can that was no ordinary human being.
Phenomenal.
Performing 4,000 years of people, places, and things in the space of 33 and a half years. Keep reading Psalms.
And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water.
Now he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. This is John the Baptist planting him.
Mm-hmm.
by the rivers of water. Because why? When we go into it, you find out this was the seed of Abraham. Because Abraham was given a promise that through his seed, all the families of the earth would be blessed. Well, here's that seed here being planted by the rivers of water. I mean, just from a natural standpoint, when you want something to grow, you plant a seed.
Right.
You plant seeds to, you know, in the ground to make things. Well, this is the seed, you know. And he's being planted here, read.
That bringeth forth his fruit in the season.
And then when he died, see, because that's what happens when you plant a seed, the seed has to die. Right. And it's the inner germ of the seed that comes through, or the spirit that comes through, death and burial. And then here he is resurrected. He didn't resurrect by himself. Right. He resurrected with an army. Those who died in the faith from Adam to John the Baptist. They who believe, resurrected with him. In other words, bringing forth fruit. When you plant a corn seed in the ground, you just don't expect a little seed to come back up.
Right.
You expect some ears of corn.
Right.
You expect some, especially for your labor. You know, you've been out there chopping and hoeing and all that. You know, you want to enjoy the fruits of your labor.
That's right. Yeah.
You know? So you're not expecting, you know, you're going to do the best you can to create the conditions.
Right.
So that you can get the best yield for your harvest.
Exactly.
Read.
His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper.
And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Read.
The wicked are not so.
Now the wicked, they ain't like that. Read.
But are like the chaff which the wind driveth away.
Read.
Therefore the wicked shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
Read.
For Yahweh knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall perish.
See, they ain't going to be in the congregation of the righteous. See, here's Yahshua resurrecting and all those righteous souls resurrecting with him.
Right.
See, those souls coming in on Pentecost, see? See, and then 7 years later, the Gentiles coming in. And it continues on to this day. Okay, now go back to Matthew. Let's finish that up a little bit.
15.
And
Joshua answered and said unto him,
Permit
it to be so now,
for
thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
It becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. What do you mean the us? He was the Word made flesh.
Right.
And he's talking about the Holy Spirit in John. So thus it permitted us to fulfill or perform this righteousness. The only way a person could be righteous at that time was if they could do these 613 ordinances.
Right.
This was their righteousness. And no one could do it until he came along and performed it. When he performed it, that brought an end to it. That was the end of water baptism at the cross. But see, the whole body of Israel had to be baptized unto his death so that they would resurrect in the likeness of his resurrection, which is spiritual. Anything else there?
Joshua, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descending like a dove and lighting upon him.
All right, keep that in mind. We may reference that a little later. Get Matthew 5:17. I just want to get this institutional fulfillment thing out here. His mission. Define what his mission is. That's what I thought. But who is this guy? Everybody and their grandmother got an opinion on who and what this person was. Okay? And I've heard it all too, buddy. I have. I've heard it all. But this is what we tell you what he is based on what he said. He said, and we read it from the scripture, this is the Word made flesh. Now, he came in the likeness of sinful flesh. I mean, if he was standing up in here right now as he was, we wouldn't be able to tell the difference.
That's right. Yeah.
You know? We really wouldn't. Because he looked just like anybody else. Anybody else here, just, you know. And the scripture says there wasn't nothing comely about him.
Right.
Wasn't anything comely about this guy, you know. You know, like you know, like rock stars or celebrities, like, oh, you know. He didn't look like that. He wasn't like that.
Right.
Just a carpenter's son, so to speak, as far as they knew and understood. Okay. Read.
Think not that I come to destroy the law or the prophets. I come not to destroy, but to fulfill.
Okay, so now he said, I come not to destroy, but to fulfill. And the word fulfill means to bring to an end.
Right.
But also means to perform, because when you perform something, you're bringing it to an end. Like, for example, if I bought a car and I went to the loan company and I got a car, you know, note, and so they said, okay, you got to pay X amount of money for 33 months, all right? Okay, now if I miss a payment, they'll let me know. Mm-hmm. And if I make a late payment, then I got to pay interest or whatever. But if I dutifully pay my 33 payments on time and all that, when I make my 33rd payment, and I go in there and make my 33rd payment, the horns will start blaring, the balloons and the confetti will come down, and you know, the double doors will open, and the loan manager will come floating out on a cloud, say, oh, congratulations, Mr. Williams. You know, you have fulfilled your obligation to us, and therefore, we are going to award you with the title to your car, you know. Why? Because I fulfilled my obligation to them,
right,
and paid 33 payments. I performed 33 payments, mm-hmm, to its conclusion, to the end. And that's what he did. See? Keep reading.
For verily I say unto you,
uh-huh,
till heaven and earth pass, one yod, or the smallest part of the letter, shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled.
Till all be fulfilled, or performed and brought to an end. John 5:36.
But I have greater witnesses than that of John.
Now, I got a greater witness. He's speaking here. I got a greater witness than this guy out here standing in the middle of this river, wearing a camel hair suit, you know, with a bag full of dried locusts and some honeycomb, with his hair all wild. I got, and listen, John the Baptist, people really did consider John the Baptist to be a prophet indeed. Okay? They did. And so, you know, I mean, he was a spectacle. And he was like, you know, repent ye, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then he saw Yahshua walking down the riverside one day. I pointed him out and said, behold, mm-hmm, the Lamb of Yahweh that taketh away the sin of the world. That was his job. But now Yahshua is saying, look, I got a greater witness than that guy. And he was a witness. He was a forerunner.
Right.
He was a herald to point out the Messiah. I'm talking about John the Baptist. But he's saying, I got a greater witness than that. Read.
For the works which the Father had given me to do,
uh-huh,
to finish, the same works I do, and they bear witness of me that the Father has sent me.
They say, now the works that the Father has given me to finish. Not start, but to finish.
Right.
What is he doing? He got circumcised. He got baptized. He ate the Passover, which we euphemistically call the Lord's Supper. He did ceremonies, sacrifices, Ten Commandment law, tithing, 613 ordinances, which he performed to finish. Not to start, but to finish.
Right.
They were all... Why? How can you initiate something that was already initiated? This was already going on.
Right. Mm-hmm.
He came to finish this so that he can institute a new testament written in the heart and in the mind.
That's right.
Read.
And the Father himself, which has sent me, have bore witness of me.
Uh-huh.
Ye have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape.
Seen his shape. See, he's talking about back there with Moses. Because, see, Moses did. He saw him. And they read Moses. They know. They knew about Moses. They were well steeped in Moses. When I say that, I mean the Old Testament. They knew what it said. They could quote you. They just go on and on. I'm talking about these scribes and Pharisees,
right,
Sadducees and stuff. They were scholars. They were the scholars of their day. They were different sects. They had their different beliefs. Just like today, we got different sects today.
Right.
They had them back there, different sects and stuff. But read.
And ye have not his word abiding in you.
Uh-huh.
Abiding in you. For whom he has sent, him ye believe not.
Mm-hmm.
Ye search the scriptures.
Now I said, you search the scriptures. Now, he's speaking. Mm-hmm. Now, when he said, you search the scriptures, the only books they had at that time, as we said earlier, was the Old Testament.
Right.
Those books that we know from Genesis to Malachi.
Right.
Books that we know, so-called New Testament, books like Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the letters of Paul, the letters of Peter, Titus, Timothy, the book of Revelation, Jude, they didn't exist.
Right.
When he made that statement, you search the scriptures. So what scriptures could he have been talking about? None other than the Old Testament. Why search the Old Testament? Read.
For in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Now for in them, he's talking to the scribes and Pharisees because they knew the scriptures. They said, now in them, because you think you know the scriptures so well, you think you have eternal life because you know what's in the book.
Right.
But read.
And they are they which testify of me.
And they are they which testify of me. What? You mean to tell me when I'm reading something in the Old Testament about Adam, I'm really not reading about Adam?
Right.
I'm reading about him.
That's right.
So you mean to tell me if I'm reading something in the Old Testament about Noah, I'm really not reading about Noah.
No.
I'm reading about him.
That's right.
So if I'm reading something in the Old Testament about Jeremiah or Isaiah or Ezekiel or Joshua, I'm not really reading about them. I'm really reading about him.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're testifying to him.
Right.
To point him out.
That's right.
That's not to say these stories didn't happen. Yes, there was such a thing as Adam and Eve. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
There was such a thing as Moses and the children of Israel. Yes, there was.
Right.
Those are, you know, some people say, well, those are fables and stuff. No, those are actual stories that really did happen. Because he said they happened.
Mm-hmm.
And he performed them and fulfilled them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Is there anything else there?
This word. But ye will not come to me,
uh-huh,
that ye might have life.
Read.
I receive not honor from men,
uh-huh,
but I know you, that ye have not the love of Elohim in you.
Mm-hmm.
I am come in my Father's name.
Oh, wait a minute here. I come in my Father's name. Well, wait a minute. What is my Father's name?
Right.
Well, my Father's name is the Lord. Oh, you mean to tell me your name is Lord Junior?
Mm-hmm.
Or God Junior? Yeah, I mean, if that's your Father's name. But see, Lord and God are not names. They're
right.
Titles.
Right.
Lord is an English title. God, it comes from Gott, which is a Germanic deity. He said, I come in my Father's name. And there's no connection to Lord God and Jesus Christ. There's no linguistic connection with that. Lord is English. God is... Oh, come over here. Lord is English. God is German. Hey, Zeus... Originally, it comes from Greek, because it comes from Zeus. And part of A comes from a Babylonian deity. Christ comes from Krishna, Christos, which is derived from Krishna, which is a Hindu. So here you got an English, Germanic, Babylonian, Greek, Hindu deity coming and appearing to a bunch of Hebrews out here. You know, talking about I'm the one. Okay? And they're like, you know, like they're supposed to identify with that. Okay? But that's not happening. But read on.
I come in my Father's name, and you receive me not.
I come in my Father's name. My Father's name is Yahweh. My name is Yahshua. Yah is a contraction of Yahweh. Shua means salvation. So his name, Yahshua, simply means Yahweh is salvation. And that's what he came to do,
right,
to save.
That's right.
That was his mission, to save. The word Savior is nowhere in Jesus Christ, mm-hmm, in the meaning of it. Nowhere. And it's not even Hebrew. He was a Hebrew.
Mm-hmm.
And they did worship Yahweh, which he appeared to the Hebrews. But Yahweh is a universal name.
Mm-hmm.
We may get to that in a little bit, but I'm just setting up some prelims here. But keep reading.
Let another come in his own name.
Now, you let another come in his own name, and we've all done that. Let somebody else come in their own name. You know, Jesus, Krishna, Buddha, Allah. Your preacher, my preacher, your guru, your sensei, your iman, you know, yourself, if you're an atheist. you let somebody else's name come along, you'll accept that. See, but let him come in his own name. See, him, you know, you won't receive. And listen, this ain't strange to us. You talk to a good theologian, somebody who's been to cemetery school, seminary school. And they will tell you that, the name is Yahweh. And the true name of Yahshua is Yahshua. They'll tell you that. But ain't no money in it.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's why this place ain't filled up, you know. And I'm not getting paid a salary for this either. None of us are, for that matter. Because
right.
My salary is eternal life.
Right.
As we used to say this in the old days. And say, well, you know, doing this, you know, the pay is lousy. But the retirement benefits are extraordinary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't beat eternal life. Okay? But the point is, his name is Yahshua. See, for one thing, there's no J in the Hebrew alphabet. The J, which is the 10th letter of the English alphabet, is the newest letter of the English alphabet. It didn't come around until like about 300 or 400 years ago. Mm-hmm. So if the J was, you know, didn't come around until then, so what was they calling him back then?
Right.
And somebody would say, well, this is the English translation of his name. No, this is the Hebrew right here. Mm-hmm. Right. This is his name in Hebrew. The Hebrew is read from right to left. And this is the translation of it from the Hebrew. Mm-hmm. It ain't this. See, but see, but as they tell me, follow the money. Mm-hmm. See, there's more money. See, we would have this place packed up, and I've always said this. If we as a group would just simply change the name of Yahweh Elohim to Lord God Jesus Christ and just change that, just that, and still keep preaching what we preach as far as what we preach, this place would be full. Mm-hmm. Just because people gravitate to that name.
Right.
More so than they would gravitate to the truth. Because right. Why? Because everybody else is doing it. Oh, that's all right. You know, we're doing it, and I'm doing it. Okay, you know, anybody feels good in a crowd. You know, herd mentality. You know, like the folks that marched on the, you know, be marched on the state capitol with guns, you know. It's a solidarity. You got your gun, I got my gun. Okay, yeah, we're going together. A solidarity type thing. It's the same way. Just taking a look at it on the world. Oh, okay, you believe in Jesus? Oh, I believe in Jesus too. Yeah, all right. We're going with Jesus together. Instead of sitting up thinking and looking at the evidence. This. In fact, to me, I would say people that believe in Jesus Christ is the same, it's probably about the same level that people believe in the flat earth. Because yeah. The evidence is overwhelming that the earth is round. Okay?
Yeah.
Just like the evidence is overwhelming that his name is Yahshua.
Right.
But you would rather believe because, well, my daddy believed or my grandma believed. It was good enough for them, it was good enough for me, you know.
Right.
That kind of thing. And that's the way we are as humans. Instead of sitting down and just looking at something analytically and looking at the evidence that is there. Okay? Did we finish that up?
44. How can you believe which receive honor one of another and not seek the honor that cometh from Elohim only?
Mm-hmm.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuses you, even Moses, in whom you trust.
Oh, wait, even Moses in whom you trust. He's talking to the scribes and Pharisees. He said, even Moses in whom you trust, because...
For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me.
Uh-huh.
For he wrote of me.
Moses wrote of Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked Christians, I said, you know, show me in the Bible where Moses wrote about Jesus Christ. You ain't going to find it.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahshua...
Yep.
You will find in the Old Testament, in everybody's Bible,
mm-hmm.
Moses writing about Yahshua. You will find that. Okay? Because he was Hebrew. And that's a Hebrew name.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to wake Moses up talking about, hey, Moses, yeah, you know, why don't you tell us, you know, he said that he wrote about you, talking about Jesus Christ. He wrote about, tell us something about Jesus Christ. More than likely, Moses would probably say, Jesus Christ? Oy boy, sounds Greek to me. That's what he was saying.
Yep.
Because it is. Okay? Now, he said, go back and see what Moses wrote.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, to do that, we have to go back. Because he said that.
Right.
I'm not, because see, a lot of people say, oh, you people read the Old Testament. Well, he said Moses wrote of him. Well, if Moses wrote of him, then I got to go back and see what Moses wrote
right.
to find out what Moses wrote about him.
Mm-hmm.
So then we're going to have to begin at the beginning with Moses, right?
Right.
And that would be Exodus, the third chapter.
Exodus 3 and 1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert mm-hmm. and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb. And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush.
Now, let me say something at this point. This is the beginning of the Bible, right?
Right.
This is where the Bible begins. Now, somebody will say, well, wait a minute, I thought Genesis was the first book of the Bible. In fact, it says in Genesis, in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Well, Moses is the one who wrote the book of Genesis.
Right.
How did Moses write about the book of Genesis? See? So you have to see Genesis really didn't come first. You have to see, first you got to introduce the main character, which is Moses here. How did he come into play? When did he write the book of Genesis? How was it shown to him? Well, first you gotta begin at the, this is where it begins. Because Moses is out here minding his own business, being a shepherd. Till he sees a phenomenal sight, a bush burning that's not being consumed. Now, we would understand that here in California because they tell you about fires and stuff out here. Mm-hmm. Don't ditch your cigarette out the car when you're driving through the mountains and stuff like that. Because things catch fire, you know. And go. But here, it's not doing that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not doing that here. And the reason why it's not doing that is because this is a vision that's being given to Moses out here. If you and I were standing next to Moses, we would not be seeing this. This is a divine vision given to Moses out here at this burning bush. Continue.
And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Uh-huh.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn.
Because he's in the desert, he's in the wilderness, an arid area, and you know how things catch on fire. He said, wait a minute, I see it burning, but it's not spreading. It's not, you know, wow, this is interesting. Mm-hmm. So he's going to go check it out. Read.
And when Yahweh saw that, he turned aside to see. Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush,
mm-hmm.
and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thy standest is holy ground.
Mm-hmm.
Moreover, he said, I am the Elohim of thy father, the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows.
Mm-hmm.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptian oppressed them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said unto Elohim, who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh,
mm-hmm.
and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? And he said, certainly I will be with thee, and this shall be a token unto thee that I have sent thee. When thou hast brought forth the people out of Egypt, you shall serve Elohim upon this mountain. And Moses said unto Elohim, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel,
mm-hmm.
and shall say unto them,
mm-hmm.
the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them?
Now, that's a very logical question the man is asking. I'm talking about Moses. Because if you knew about the history of Moses, Moses was a man who was raised up in the household of Pharaoh in Egypt.
Right.
Egypt is a... It's a nation of many gods and deities. Practically everything was a god or a goddess. And they all had names.
Mm-hmm.
So it's quite logical when Moses comes out here and says, okay, who should I tell them what your name is? Read that same passage out of the King James Bible.
And Moses said unto God, behold, when I come into the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your father sent me unto you.
Mm-hmm.
And they shall say to me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them?
Now he just said, when I tell him the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, what shall I say his name is? Well, wait a minute, didn't he just call him God?
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was his name.
Yeah.
God is not a name, it's a title. Because he's asking a good question. He said, when I say the God of your fathers, what should I say is his name? Every God has a name.
Right.
I used to read Greek mythology growing up. I used to love, you know, about Zeus and Hercules and stuff. I used to love the Norse stuff too, you know, about Asgard and Thor, Loki, Odin, and, you know. But they all got names. They all got names. And said, well, God, you know, I've had people tell me, you know. And like, you just stop and think for a minute. Because we read in Proverbs what Solomon said. He said, how Yahweh possessed me from the beginning of his ways, and I did all this. Now, here you got a deity that can create the sun, moon, stars, the galaxies, and all that, create the earth, all the plants, the animals, can create you. And he doesn't have the capability to convey to somebody what his name is.
Mm-hmm.
And here you are. You ain't done none of this stuff. And yet you quick when somebody call you out your name. Mm-hmm. See? And you will reaffirm and reassess what your name is. And right. My name is whatever. Mm-hmm. And you're able to express that, but you ain't did nothing grand and grandiose like the Creator has. But he can't convey what his name is. He can do all of this, but he can't convey who he is.
Right.
Just stop and think for a minute. Some stuff, and I'll finally just say, don't even take horses. Okay? But that's the world we lived under. Right. We came up under. You know? That kind of thing, you know, was just, you know, smooshed it over, and we just said, oh, okay, and we didn't know any better.
Right.
We honestly didn't.
Right.
But we finish reading the King James Version.
Okay. And God said unto Moses, I am that I am.
Now he said, I am that I am. Now that right there is an error.
Right.
I am that I am. Why? Because it shows limitation. See? I am that I am is something Popeye the Sailor could say.
Mm-hmm.
I am is what I am, and that's all that I am. I am a sailor man who loves spinach.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I like getting fights and love getting into fights with Bluto over this skinny chip over here.
What's her name, Olive Oil?
You know,
yeah.
But that's it. But now read the Holy Name Version.
And Elohim said unto Moses, Eya Asher Eya.
Now that's a big difference. And see, this can be verified by looking it up in a Jewish encyclopedia.
Right.
Because translated it means, I will be what I will to be. Now that is a lot more expansive.
Right.
See, that's a lot more limitless, if you will. I will be what I will to be. I will be the sun, the moon, the stars. I will be the plants, the animals. I will be a man. I will be what I will to be. Why? Because I'm already that in the first place.
Right. Okay.
Because Yahweh, pure spirit, this is the all in all. This is the source and substance of everything. Whatever you think can exist or can't exist, he's the source of it. So now, look here. The word Yah.
Right.
It's in the phrase. That should tell you something.
That's right.
I Yahweh.
I will be what I will. You can substitute the I. You can say Yahweh
right.
will be what Yahweh will to be.
That's right.
Yahweh will to be a universe, an angelic creation, and a physical creation, and populated it. He willed that. Matter is spirit materialized. It's the transmutation of that. Keep reading quickly so we can move on.
And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I will be, has sent me unto you.
Read.
And Elohim said, moreover unto Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel,
mm-hmm.
Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers,
uh-huh.
the Elohim of Abraham, the Elohim of Isaac, and the Elohim of Jacob,
mm-hmm.
has sent me unto you.
Mm-hmm.
This is my name forever.
This is my name forever. Mm-hmm. Read.
And this is my memorial unto all generations.
I think we're still living in forever.
Yep.
Right.
I still think we're living in all generation.
Right.
This is my, and then I'll say something else on top of this. Moses was the first creature,
mm-hmm.
human or angel, of which Yahweh revealed his name to. Prior to Moses, they did not know his name. Adam, who was the first man created, did not know the name Yahweh.
Right.
Noah didn't know. Abraham didn't know. This is representative of Michael and Gabriel, two archangels.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't know the name Yahweh until Moses received it here. The angels were like, oh, really? That's his name? Okay. They knew him as Elohim, El Shaddai. They knew that, but they did not know his name. Not until he told Moses. So now he's going to send Moses down. Get to where Aaron is. I think it's the fourth chapter.
Yeah.
About his speaking skills.
Okay, let's go with 9.
And it shall come to pass, if they will not believe, also these two signs.
Now Yahweh had given them signs. I'll throw that in there. He gave them signs. to show the people down there. He told Moses to stick his hand in his bosom, pull it out, and it would turn leprous as snow, turn white. Hmm. Stick it back in, pull it out, it would be his natural flesh. He was told to take his rod and throw it on the ground, and it would turn into a serpent. Pick it up by the tail, and it would turn back into a rod. And he was also told that if they didn't believe those signs, to go down to the Nile River, get some water out of it, and pour it on the ground, and it will turn to blood. Mm-hmm. Those are three signs that Moses is given to show Pharaoh, you know, the proof that Yahweh sent him. All right, but read.
I'm going to pick it up at 10. And Moses said unto Yahweh, but O Yahweh, I am not eloquent, neither heretofore nor since thou hast spoken unto thy servant.
Mm-hmm.
But I am slow of speech mm-hmm. and of a slow tongue.
See, in other words, he had a speech impediment. He wasn't like Charleston Heston in the movie Ten Commandments. You know, he was malevolently and long, majestic. Oh, and all this. No, he had a speech impediment. He stuttered.
Mm-hmm.
Seriously. Talking about Moses. He seriously had a speech impediment. And he said, and so he's throwing that up as an excuse. Well, you know, I can't talk, you know, all that great. You know, I mean, I'm slow, you know. And so this is Yahweh's response.
And Yahweh said unto him, who has made man's mouth?
Uh-huh.
Or who has maketh the dumb or deaf mm-hmm. or the seeing or the blind? Have not I, Yahweh?
Mm-hmm.
Now therefore go, and I will be with thy mouth
mm-hmm.
and teach thee what thou shalt say.
Read.
And he said, O Yahweh, send, I pray thee, by the hand of him whom thou wilt send.
You know, Moses said, yeah, well, I pray, you know, you find that guy. That's because it came from me.
And the angel of Yahweh was kindled against Moses.
Yeah, well, now the angel's starting to get pissed off. He's in a hurry, you know. He's like, okay, look here. You know?
And he said, is not Aaron the Levite thy brother?
Now, see, isn't Aaron the Levite your brother? And I said, now, how would he know about Aaron? Now, mm-hmm. he's asking Moses about a brother he ain't seen in 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Yeah.
Read.
I know that he can speak well.
Go ahead.
And also, behold, he cometh forth to meet thee.
Now, how does he know that? Remember, we read in the verse early on, he said, I know about what the Egyptians is doing right. to the Israelites, and I am come down.
That's right. Yeah.
To deliver them. What do you mean? I'm down here in Egypt
yeah.
as a man, and I'm looking at this, and I'm down here. And I'm talking to you while I'm astral, and you know, he was down here too. Man, mm-hmm. we won't have time for it, but you come back and we'll get into it. How? Because we told you Moses wrote about Joshua
right
down here. Joshua the son of Nun was down here with Moses.
Right.
See, and that's why he could tell Aaron and say, "Well, I know your brother Aaron speaks well because I'm talking to him right now,
right.
and I'm sending him on, and I'm sending him out. He's on his way
mm-hmm.
to come meet you out in the middle of this desert somewhere." Because I'm talking to him now.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, how's he talking to Aaron? And he's talking to Moses up here at the same time. Oh, it's a process. It's a trick. It's called astral projection. And it's nothing else. And it's nothing no trickier about it because everybody does it.
Mm-hmm.
You might think it's a real vivid dream or lucid dream, as you may say, but everybody does it. Astral projection. That is to say, the projection of your consciousness from your
right.
body to go somewhere else.
Right.
And then return back to your body at a particular time. Oh, that's documented. It's even in the scriptures. Okay, and we're showing it to you right here because here's Joshua, son of Nun, with Aaron, and he's astral projecting out here to Moses at this burning bush, and he's talking to him. He said, yeah, I know your brother Aaron. He speaks well. I'm talking to him now, and I'm sending him out here to see you, to visit you, to meet with you. Why? Because both of them come, or keep reading.
And when he seeth thee, he will be glad in his heart.
Uh-huh.
And thou shalt speak unto him and put words in his mouth.
Now you're going to speak to Aaron and you're going to put words in his mouth mm-hmm. on what to say. Because he's a good speaker, right? Read.
And I will be with thy mouth and with his mouth.
And I'm going to tell you what to say and you're going to tell him what to say. In other words, you're going to be my law
right.
and prophet.
Right.
Two witnesses. And that's what's happening here. Aaron's coming out here to meet Moses, and both of them coming down together. Two witnesses, two divine witnesses, the law and the prophets, to render judgment mm-hmm. upon Pharaoh and Egypt. Mm-hmm. All right? Now, I'm not going to go through it, but there were 10 devastating plagues that came, you know, that came forth. I mean, and listen, those plagues that Yahweh plagued the Egyptians with, like darkness and
mm-hmm.
the sickness of the cattle, the frogs, the flies, the changing of the Nile River to blood. The reason why Yahweh hit them with those
plagues
is because these were the gods that the Egyptians worshipped.
Right.
The Nile River was a goddess. So when the Nile, that was the first plague. So when the Nile River turned to blood, don't you think them people were praying their hearts out for the goddess to come back?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, to the point of flagellating themselves. You know, like, you know what flagellation is? You know, when you beat yourself. You know, please, you know, bloody up, you know, just to show you, please, we're sincere, come back. And she didn't. See, they worshiped the frog down there. Then all of a sudden you had a plague of frogs everywhere.
Right.
Filling up the houses with frogs. I mean, of your God that you worship. Oh, please, frog God, that's enough. Okay, it's enough. We don't want no more frogs. And it didn't stop.
Right.
Or like 3 days of Stygian darkness. Darkness so thick, you can feel it. Darker than 1,000 midnights. Don't you think them people were praying their house parts out to Sun Ra, come back, and he didn't? These were the gods. See, Yahweh showing mastery and supremacy over the gods of Israel. Even to the point of the last plague, which was the Exodus 12 chapter. The Passover, institution of the Passover, quickly, because I need to.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, This month shall be a month, the beginning of months to you.
Mm-hmm.
It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, In the 10th day of this month shall be taken out to them every man a lamb according to the house,
mm-hmm.
father of a lamb, and father. A lamb for an house, and if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his house take it according to the number of souls.
Mm-hmm.
Every man according to his eatings shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male of the first year,
mm-hmm.
and ye shall take it out from the sheep or from the goat. And ye shall keep it up until the 14th day of the same month. And the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it between the two evenings.
Mm-hmm.
And ye shall take of the blood and strike it on the two doorposts and on the upper doorposts of the houses, wherein ye shall eat it. Ye shall eat of it, of the flesh, in the night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs ye shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor boiled at all with water, nor roast it with fire. His heads and his legs with the inwards thereof. Ye shall not let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it upon the morning ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded,
mm-hmm.
shoes on your feet, staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is Yahweh's Passover.
Okay, this is Yahweh's Passover. And the reason why it's a Passover is because they had to put this blood sign on the door because the angel, the death angel, would pass over their houses. Mm-hmm. If this blood sign was on the door, they would literally pass over the house. But if the blood sign was not on the door, then they wouldn't pass over. They'd stop by and pay you a visit.
Right.
And say they would kill the firstborn of man and beast. And this was particularly hard-hitting because Pharaoh's firstborn son died in this. And Pharaoh was considered to be a god.
Right.
You mean to tell me you can kill the God's son, and he can't bring him back to life? See, this is Yahweh showing mastery over all the deities of Egypt, that there's only one Yahweh, okay? Now, these folks, they had to have their loins girded and the shoes on their feet, and they had to eat it in haste, and they had to eat it all right? There were 10 devastating plagues. The first three plagues, the Israelites and the Egyptians experienced, but the last seven was on the Egyptians only. As the Israelites, they lived separate from them. They lived in the land of Goshen. So now, after the death of the firstborn, Pharaoh's heart was hardened. But see, it wasn't that Pharaoh, if it was up to Pharaoh, he would have let them go after the first plague.
Right.
He said, oh, man, and now we return to blood, man, y'all going to get up out of here.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahweh hardened his heart,
mm-hmm.
see, for a purpose, to show forth his power. See, his power over the gods, over the so-called gods of Egypt, okay? So now when they let him go, and they marched out, they followed a phenomenal cloud. Let's get there. I think that's Exodus, it's the 13th chapter, maybe. Because I want to get this in here. I want to try to, yeah.
13 and I'll start 21. And Yahweh went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go in day and night.
So now they followed a phenomenal cloud. Okay, see, you don't hear that, you know, talk too much. And I don't even remember seeing that in the movie. Was that in the movie? Mm-mm. Ten Commandments, a phenomenal cloud? I don't remember seeing that. And you would think, you know, they would have that particular part in there. Right. But see, it was a phenomenal cloud that they followed. We have it right here. See? And it was, keep reading. It was like the Israelites, right? You read that, right?
He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day.
The cloud, read.
Nor the pillar of fire by night.
And it was a pillar of fire by night. So the Israelites were in constant light. Mm-hmm. They were moving with the cloud or in the cloud. All right?
Before the people.
Go ahead.
And Yahweh spoke unto Moses, saying, speak ye unto all the Israel.
Not okay, jump. No, that's okay. Jump down to, because they're following the cloud, they're going to the Red Sea. Let's see. 12? No. 8. Start at 8. 14 and 8.
And Yahweh hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt.
Now he hardened Pharaoh's heart. Again, after Pharaoh done let him go, you know, then Yahweh hardened his heart again and said, wait a minute, our slaves is gone. Hey, man, we're going to get our slaves. Yeah. Who's going to do this work here? You know? So Yahweh hardened his heart again, and he came after them. Read.
And he pursued after the children of Israel. And the children of Israel went out with the high hand. And the Egyptians pursued after them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh and his horsemen and his army, and took over them, encamping by the sea besides Pilar and Beelzebub. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. And they were so afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto Yahweh and said unto Moses, because there is no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, for we have served the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than for us then we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, pray ye not, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh, mm-hmm. which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians who you have seen today, you shall see again no more forever.
Okay, now he says, stand still and see the salvation of Yahweh. Now we got the English translation, mm-hmm. but when you really think about it and look at it, he was saying, stand still and see Yahshua. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Because we told you the name Yahshua means Yahweh is salvation, right. or mm-hmm. salvation of Yahweh. So he says, stand still and see Yahshua. Mm-hmm. Read.
Yahweh shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. And Yahweh said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou to me?
Now wait a minute. He says, wherefore criest thou to me? Where's he speaking from? Mm. Is it from the sky somewhere?
No.
Is it within Moses' brain?
No.
No, he's standing right next to Moses. And he's turning to Moses and he said, why are you crying to me?
Really?
Speak unto the children of Israel.
You speak to the Israelites because there ain't time for them to see me yet.
Mm-hmm.
That they go forward.
Uh-huh.
But lift up thy rod.
Lift up your rod.
And stretch thy hand over the sea.
And stretch your hand over the sea.
Divide it.
And divide it. See, you know, it's lift up your rod and stretch your hand over the sea and divide it.
And the children of Israel shall go on dry land.
And they shall go on dry land. And then look, and it didn't divide like the way it did in that movie. Because they showed it going, splitting apart. It formed a tunnel. In other words, the waters heaped up and it formed a tunnel and touched in the midline. It was a tunnel that they went through. On dry ground, a tunnel effect. And they followed this phenomenal cloud that was a pillar of fire by day, by night, and a cloud by day. See, and they followed and they went through it. Keep your finger there. Get 1 Corinthians 10 and 1. Because people say, well, you know, you guys reading that Old Testament stuff. I'm a New Testament Christian, and you know, we don't read stuff, and you know, they we don't read stuff about the Old Testament. You know, was ever in the New Testament, that's what I'm about. But read this.
Read it.
1 Corinthians 10:1.
This is the so-called New Testament. Read.
Moreover, brethren.
This is Paul writing. This is Paul who wrote Corinthians, right? Read.
I would not that you should be ignorant how that all our fathers was under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
He's writing about it. I'm talking about Paul. He's writing about this, what we're just reading about here. Read.
And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
Baptized in the cloud and in the sea. In other words, there was death in the death of the Lamb. Then they were baptized in the cloud and the sea, and then they resurrected on the other side. That's a death, burial, resurrection.
Right.
Read.
And did all eat the same spiritual food.
Read.
And did all drink the same spiritual drink.
Read.
For they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them.
That went with them. The one that was standing next to Moses saying, why are you crying unto me? Read.
And that rock was the Messiah.
And that rock was the Messiah. Or in the King James Bible, it'll say, and that rock was Christ.
Right.
Even they know.
Right.
He was back there with them. That's why he said Moses wrote about me. Because
right.
I was with him. Mm-hmm. I was standing next to him. He was back there. See? Keep reading.
But with many of them, Yahweh was not willing.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. Exodus.
Okay, 14:7.
Even though that was good, I mean, we can go off on that, I'm telling you. But I'm just trying to lay some basics out here. Yeah.
And I behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians.
Where are you at, my dear?
14:17.
Okay, go ahead.
And they shall follow them. And I will get the honor unto Pharaoh, and upon his host, upon his chariots, and upon his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am Yahweh when I have gotten me honor upon Pharaoh and upon his chariots and upon his horsemen. And the angel of Elohim, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went behind them. And the cloud and the pillary cloud went from the face and stood behind them. And it came between the camp and the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud of darkness to them, but it was light by night to these, so shall that one came near other all by night.
Okay, so it was a light to the Israelites, but darkness to the Egyptians
right.
when they crossed over, okay? And when I'm just cutting it up.
Go ahead.
Once the Israelites came through, the Egyptians, they tried to follow through as well. Mm-hmm. But the sea collapsed in on them, and they died, and they were buried in it. Whereas the Israelites went through a death, a burial, and they came out on the other side of resurrection. You see? See, these are principles that permeate throughout the scriptures to prove the validity of who the Messiah really is. All right? Now, let's see how much time I got. Okay, I may as well get the third one in here. Third tenet. The Israelites come to Mount Sinai. It was told to Moses that he would bring them to Mount Sinai.
Mm-hmm.
And this phenomenal cloud that led them. Where's it at? 23:20, I think.
Yeah. Exodus 23:20. Behold, I sent an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared. Beware of him and obey his voice.
Mm-hmm.
Provoke him not,
uh-huh.
for he will not pardon your transgressions. For my name is in him.
My name is in this angel who's in this cloud. Well, what name is that?
Gosh.
If his name is Yahweh and his name is in him, then the name of that angel in that cloud would have to be
Joshua.
Or who we know as Joshua, son of Nun, who was really Yahshua.
Right.
That Moses wrote about. Moses wrote about Yahshua, but he never wrote a thing about Jesus. And this is the same Yahshua who was with Moses. It's the same Yahshua who came down here and died on the cross.
Mm-hmm.
The same one. Because that's the power of Yahweh. I could take on a body and take it off anytime I want.
Anytime, that's right.
That's what he can do. That's what he has done.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Moses brought these Israelites to Mount Sinai. He's going up one trip. And The first trip he goes up, he gets instructions to get the Israelites to gather around the mount. Don't touch the mount, don't touch their wives for 3 days, and Yahweh will speak upon them. And he did. He spoke down the Ten Commandment law to them. Now get Exodus 24 and 1. Quickly, I'll try to get this in. We only got about.
And he said unto Moses, come up unto Yahweh, thou, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off.
Uh-huh.
And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh.
He said, not Moses alone. I said, I want you guys to come up, and you guys are going to be on a plateau. Mm-hmm. But Moses by himself, I want him to come up and visit me up in this cloud. Alone and by himself. All right? Anything else with that?
But they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him.
Now, the people ain't going to go up, and these guys, they're not going to come up. But just you, Moses, come up in this cloud by yourself. Now, let's get 24, 9, and 10.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Now, they saw the Elohim of Israel. Now, just to throw this in here, since we're on the name, read that out the King James Version and quickly get John 1:18. Now read that in the King James right quick. You're right there. Just read it.
Are you going to get it?
Read the King James 24. You don't have it? Okay.
Yeah,
I thought you were there.
Yeah, me too.
9. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the God of Israel.
Now they saw the God of Israel. That's what the King James Version says. Now John 1:18 says, King James, John 1:18. I know I did say it.
Yeah. John 1:18.
No man has seen the Father at any time.
Now that's the holy name. That's the proper. But the King James says
no God.
Hello.
No man has seen
man.
God.
No man has seen
come on,
God.
I need some volume with these things. I don't know why. Maybe my hearing is bad.
Okay, 1:18 of John. No man has seen God at any time.
No man has seen God at any time. And we just read they saw the God of Israel. Mm-hmm. And the first thing someone will say, the Bible contradicts itself. Mm-hmm. See, it says no man has seen God. And then it says here they saw the God of Israel. Well, that's because of the titles and the names.
Right.
When you have the proper names and titles, then you'll be able to see the differences. They saw the Elohim of Israel, which is the word of Son. But as she read earlier, no man has seen the Father,
right,
who is Yahweh pure spirit. No one has ever seen Yahweh pure spirit at any time because he's inscrutable,
right,
inconceivable. Okay? All right, go back to Exodus. Where you at, dog?
Okay.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone,
uh-huh,
and as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
Mm-hmm.
And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
Uh-huh.
Also, they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Now, they described it, said he had a body, said he had feet, said he had hands.
Right.
So they described an anthropomorphic man.
Right.
Without flesh and blood counterparts, see, a great heavenly anthropomorphic man that they saw. Okay, quickly.
And Yahshua said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there.
And
I will
give you. Who said that?
Huh?
Read that again. Who said that? You said Yahshua said that.
Oh. And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there,
uh-huh,
and I will give thee table of stone,
uh-huh,
and a law and commandments which I have written,
mm-hmm,
that thou mayest teach them.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua.
Oh, what? Moses rose up and his minister, mm-hmm, Joshua. I thought he was told to come up alone and by himself.
Right.
Read.
And Moses went up into the mount,
mm-hmm,
of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us.
He said, tarry ye here for us. He didn't say, tarry ye here for me.
Right.
Tarry ye here for us.
Right.
But he was told to come up alone and by himself.
Mm-hmm.
Why is he coming up with him?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it would be the same with you. If I told you to come to my crib, bro, you come in there, but come by yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I meet you and say, hey, come on up, man. I'll take you over to the crib.
Mm-hmm.
Now, both of us is going up in there, but you coming by yourself. Why? Because it's my crib.
Right?
Right? Here's Joshua, son of Nun. He's the one walking up with Moses. Why is he Moses going up by himself? Because this is his crib.
Right.
It's Joshua's crib.
Right.
Talking about, yeah, because he's the angel in the cloud.
Mm-hmm.
We just read about the angel in the cloud. Even he's going, he's taking Moses up to his crib.
Yeah.
Or his place.
Right.
Read quickly.
Tarry ye here for us until we come again unto you.
Uh-huh.
And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you.
Mm-hmm.
If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them.
Read.
And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount.
Uh-huh.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now the cloud covered it 6 days, and she says cold. Now that don't say cold. She's reading. She's looking at the punctuation mark there. Because we stopped there.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason why we stopped there is because a colon in English grammar usually means that there has to be an explanation rendered
right.
of what was previously said. See, and then it goes into the seventh day, but then there's no explanation. Well, what happened during the 6 days that Moses is up here in this cloud?
Mm-hmm.
Now, you have now to understand that, you'd have to go to Genesis 1 and 1.
Right.
Because people will say, well, Moses wrote the book of Genesis. Well, how did he write it?
Right.
How did he obtain the information to write about the book of Genesis? We're showing it to you. He's up in this cloud and he's receiving a vision, because up in this vision, this is what he says.
In the beginning.
In the beginning. This is in the book of Genesis. 1 and 1. In the beginning. In the beginning of what? Because
right.
people will sit up and say, well, when did God create the heavens and the earth? In the beginning. Well, in the beginning of what? Well, just in the beginning.
Yeah.
But that's not what this book is talking about. This is not an account of the creation. This is an account of Moses receiving a vision and revelation up here in this cloud, because now he's saying in the beginning of what? In the beginning of this vision, read.
Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
And the earth became without form and void.
Uh-huh.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim and the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim said, let there be light, and there was light.
Read.
And Elohim saw the light that it was good.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness. And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day.
The evening and the morning were the first day. In other words, the one, because Moses is up here 6 days, so on that first day, he sees Elohim create light and darkness. And it took him a whole solar day to
right.
see this. Same way with the second day, with the waters and all that. See, Moses up here, he sees these 6 days that he's writing about, because he's up in this cloud for 6 days. You're in Genesis, read where it talks about the seventh day. Second chapter, probably.
Yeah. And let me...
The seventh day? The second chapter,
okay,
maybe?
Yeah.
These are the origins?
These are the origins. That's a good one.
Okay.
These are the origins of the heavens and the earth when they were created.
Uh-huh.
The day that
they were created. See, people think the heavens were created in days. It wasn't. It was created in the day of eternity. But for Moses, he had to slow it down and show him in sequential order. And it took Moses a whole solar day to see each thing that happened on that day. See, when he's up here in this cloud. Keep going.
And in the day, Yahweh Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And every plant.
That was good, but I need the seventh day.
Okay, 32. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed, and all their hosts. And on the seventh day, Elohim completed his works, which he had made.
Now he rested and completed his works. Why did he rest? Because, go back to Exodus. Exodus 24:16.
And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
Because on the seventh day he called out to Moses out of the midst. In other words, he had completed showing Moses.
Mm-hmm.
What he had completed showing him that. That's recorded in the first chapter of Genesis. This is the vision Moses is receiving when he's up here in this cloud. That's how he's able to write about the Genesis. Okay? Now he's up here 7 days.
Mm-hmm.
This cloud. Keep reading. Exodus.
And the sight of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount.
Read.
And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
Now he's up here 40 days and 40 nights. Now we've just accounted for 7 of those days.
Mm-hmm.
What was happening the other 33 days?
Right.
Quickly. Where you at?
25:9. According to all that I show thee after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall
you make it. No, you missed a line.
Oh. And Yahweh spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel that they bring me.
No, 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 was that it?
Oh, and, I'm
sorry.
And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them.
Uh-huh.
According to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it.
So now he's shown this divine tabernacle up here, okay? And it's 33 days, so that accounts for the 40 days he's up here. The first 7 days, he sees the creation of he's shown the account of the heavens and the earth, as recorded in Genesis, the first chapter. The other 33 days, he's shown the specifications for this tabernacle that they were to build in the wilderness, okay? Now, this tabernacle consists of a court roundabout, a holy place, and a most holy place. There are three compartments. There are 7 steps in this tabernacle. The first step is the gate, which I almost enter into, as Joshua said, enter ye at the straight gate. That was what he was talking about. Because this was the straight gate that all must enter into to offer this sacrifice, which is here at the altar of sin and sacrifice, which is the second step. The third step is this brazen laver, where the sacrifices were washed and the priests were washed. It's also a type of a washing of regeneration. The fourth step is the door, wherein you have the cup of holy anointing oil at the door. Okay? By which you entered into the sanctuary or the holy place. In the holy place, you have a 7-branch lampstand. See, these objects out here were made of highly polished brass, whereas these objects up here were made of gold. This was the 7-branch golden lampstand, see, which lit up the holy place. This was the table of shewbread, which had 12 loaves on it, which was the daily sustenance for the priest. This was the golden altar of incense, which incense was burnt there, by which would mask the smell of burnt flesh out here. All right. Now this is the fifth step, or the holy place. The sixth step is this second departmental veil of blue, purple, and scarlet that separated the holy place from the most holy place. The most holy place is this Ark of the Covenant, see, which was 2 archangels on top of a chest by which in it the Ten Commandments were put in there. A pot of manna, mm-hmm. and Aaron's rod that had butter and almonds. All right, this was in there. And the cloud that led the Israelites out of Egypt, this is where the cloud would sit on the Ark of the Covenant,
right,
between the 2 archangels. Where are we at? Get the last verse in the last chapter in Exodus.
And look that thou make them after their pattern, which was shown to thee in the mount.
Okay, that's the last chapter, but get the last chapter. Is that the last chapter?
Exodus, the last chapter.
Chapter 36, quickly, because I've only got about 5 minutes left, so.
Okay, last chapter, 36.
Sorry.
Verse 36?
Yes.
Exodus
40 and 36 should be, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, here we go. Then a cloud covered the tent.
What does 34 say?
Oh, that's it right there. And when the cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the children of Israel went onwards in all his journey. But if the cloud were not taken up, then they journeyed not.
Then they journeyed not. When the cloud moved, they moved. Mm-hmm. And see, and look over here. The scripture says this. You're created in the image and likeness of Elohim. Okay? And so that's why we have this chart here. Man made in the image of Elohim by the pattern of the tabernacle. See, you have a most holy place, your head region. Your chest region would be like your holy place. And the court roundabout would be like your abdominal region. All right? So here in your head region, draw a line. That would be like the Ark of the Covenant with the cloud on top. Well, look up here. Your brain is gray and white matter, which is like a cloud. And when your cloud says move, you move.
Right.
See, there were 12 tribes that surround this tabernacle. Well, look, you got 12 tribes that surround your tabernacle. See, you got a forearm, that's one up, you know, you got a forearm, upper arm, and your hand. That's 3 here. You got 3 on this side, that's 6. You got your foot, your shin, and your upper thigh. That's 3 here. You got 3 over here, 6. That's 12. Mm. 12 tribes that carry your tabernacle around, just like these 12 tribes here, you know, surrounded this tabernacle. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing in principle, because it's a divine pattern of the universe. Hebrews 8 and 5, quickly, I'll be just about done. See, and it's an awful lot, but that's basically the three tenets that we believe in: the name, the unity of the Spirit, the institution and fulfillment of the Scriptures, and the divine pattern of the universe. Right. See, because we told you over there about Spirit, water, blood, but look here on the tabernacle. His blood, his water, cup of holy anointing on at the door, it's a type of Spirit. Blood, water, Spirit, or death, burial, resurrection. It's a principle. Read.
Hebrews 8 and 5.
Uh-huh.
Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things.
Uh-huh.
As Moses was admonished of Elohim when he was about to make the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
Proceed, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shown to thee in the mount.
Now that's in the so-called New Testament. But people will sit and say, well, I'm a New Testament because I don't read nothing in the Old Testament. Well, why are they referring back to
really?
It?
Right.
Yeah.
Paul does it all the time. You get you a good Bible like a Schofield's, and you'll see that a lot of scriptures he makes, you'll find quotes of it back in the Old Testament.
Right. Reference.
Because it's drawn from that. See, the New Testament, oh, well, we didn't get into it today, but we'll get into it next time because we're out of time. All right? Because the New Testament, this was the Old Testament here, see, which was without. The New Testament is written in the heart and mind. See, that is within. It's not with pen and ink, but it's within.
Mm-hmm.
See? And that he himself, just like you had a high priest that operated the tabernacle back here, Yahshua the Messiah is the high priest that operates in your tabernacle.
Right.
Okay? We're out of time, and I thank you for your time. And I thank you guys, the First Time Business, thank you very much for coming, especially under these kind of conditions.
Mm-hmm.
We truly appreciate you for that. And we hope that you come back. If not, you can always watch us on our YouTube channel or our Facebook page. And come with your questions. You know, we're here to show you and reveal to you that which Yahweh has revealed at the end of this age, okay? And that what you see up here is in the Bible, that it goes according to a divine pattern of the universe, and that the one who died on that cross is the one who is the true resurrected Savior, see, in the Spirit, by him fulfilling these cardinal ordinances so that you wouldn't have to. Yes, sir?
When did you get to ask questions?
You got one?
No, not at this time. When you finish, I'll ask you.
Okay. No, I'm sorry. You could have raised your hand and asked the question. Okay. I'm very sorry. A lot of people like that, but me, I'm the. You can ask this guy. Ask him.
Don't worry. I was tempted to do it at least. No.
This is a school. This is a school and not a church. And in school, that's what you do in school. You raise your hand and ask questions. I don't have any problems with that. You know, if you got a question, you want, you know, something I'm saying up here that you're not quite understanding, or maybe you'll say, okay, can you elaborate or show something? That's my job as an instructor. See, my thing is simply this, and I'll read this, and I'll let that be the end. John 14:26. I'm just the instructor. I can point this and that out to you and say, well, do this, do that. I can even tell you how to study. You know, my basic method is read, research, and rehearse the matter. But the true teacher,
right,
see, of this is not me. See, that's our three R's: reading, research, rehearsing. But there's a fourth R, which is revelation, which no one has a jurisdiction over except one, and that's
right.
This one.
Mm-hmm.
That's this one.
John 14:26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, shall teach you all things,
mm-hmm,
and bring all things to your remembrance,
mm-hmm,
whatsoever I have said unto you.
Okay, that's the Holy Spirit. See, this, the Holy Spirit is the true teacher. If you learned anything today of what was said or anything, it wasn't me that imparted it to you. It was Yahshua the Messiah, who is already in you. See, revealed that to you. Okay? But again, this is a school, not a church. You got questions? Raise your hand. Bring them up. You know, and I'll be more than happy to talk to you afterwards. Okay, we're out of time. Thank you for your time and your patience. Be safe, be healthy, but the most important thing, be in Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
because that is your only hope of glory. Mm-hmm. And with those two words, thank you much. And hallelujah.
All right, that concludes this morning's lectures. Are there any announcements? No announcements? Okay, we thank everybody for listening in throughout the world, because this is live streaming, okay? And those are in different countries over there in, especially Mexico. It's in Baja California. That'd be Helen and
Corina.
I always forget her name. They're listening in. They send their regards and hi's and everything else, okay? So, hi, Karina and Helen. Okay, we have classes here Sundays, 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 7:30 to 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua, the Star, Sovereign, in our glory, majesty, dominion, and power, well, for all time, now and ever, let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah, Sean's doing it.